here. Thank you for inviting me. Congratulations on your first women's event. This is great. Taking a minute away from diapers and dishes and everything else that women do so well and multitask. It's so great. But yes, I do have a picture of my family. This is kind of a proof of life picture. Motherhood was probably not my greatest moment. Some mothers are really super amazing, and that's their area they shine in. Small example why I have to show proof of life, Aubrey Barnett. So they're all married, they have babies now. Aubrey Barnett, when she was 6 weeks old, we were living in Ohio pastoring, and we were going on vacation to Idaho. And we were packing up, and I had all of a sudden babies and bottles, and then we were taking our dog, which I really loved, my Cocker Spaniel, so the dog and the case. And I had given birth 6 weeks prior and had postpartum high blood pressure. So, we're going to the airport's an hour away, and I'm trying to time out everyone's medication, including mine. The dog has a tranquilizer, and there's bottles and babies and crud everywhere. I'm like, this just doesn't feel like a vacation. Like, I think we should just stay home and scrap it because it already stinks. It was about to get stankier as it was 4 o'clock in the morning, and I'm just popping and giving pills, and I switched pills. The dog got the blood pressure pill, and I took the tranquilizer. I was out drooling. I'm sure the dog's blood pressure was real nice and low, but not what he needed underneath the cargo plane. And my husband, the beautiful thing is, he had to take care of the child, which wasn't his MO, it was just me. So he had to take care of drooling wife and baby, which kind of brought me joy. So, hence, proof of life. God bless him. I am a grandma now, a year and 3 months and like 12 weeks. So that's where we're at. Very exciting. And they're way better mothers, so thank the Lord for that. Thank you, Jesus, that they had a higher level of achievement for being mothers. I'm going to talk to you today about being difference makers and different seasons in our lives, and that you could just be prepared for the best is yet to come. No matter who you are, where you're at, and where you're going, the best is yet to come. I'm going to share with you how that's possible and how that has happened to me. If you just pray with me. Lord, I pray my words would be your words, that the Holy Spirit would go before me. And I thank you that you're so omnipresent, that you're individually able to speak to each lady here with her season of life, her needs, her worries, concerns, that you're able to inspire and pour into her right now. And I pray that this message would speak personally and inspire through your Holy Spirit. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, I believe everybody wants to make a difference, right? I married into a family of difference makers. The men in the Barnett family are crazy. This is proof of it. You can read all about it. Pastor Tommy Barnett, did the Phoenix Valley Dream Center. He was the first one to think of the concept of a dream center, purchasing the Los Angeles Dream Center, City Queen of Angels Hospital at the age of 60, to start something like that is crazy. I think it was actually 58 years old. So what a mover and shaker. And then he would run from Phoenix all the way to Los Angeles to raise money for the LA Dream Center. He's 86 and he is still traveling the country, making sure that people who don't have hope have a place to have hope. So then you have his son, Matthew Barnett, who he sends over to Los Angeles, because obviously he didn't have anyone else, so he'd send his son, who's 17 years old, who had no right to being over in Los Angeles and who has killed it all these years later. So Matthew ran the 777 to raise money for the Dream Center. This is seven marathons in 7 days, but on seven different continents. Yes, very few people have accomplished this. Private plane with all these different men that are going from Antarctica to Africa to Australia, a wild 7 days. So he did accomplish this and was able to just bring awareness to the Dream Center. And then my husband and my daughter hiked the Arizona Trail for the Shark Creek Dream Center, which I'll share with you in a little bit. That is 800 miles from the border of Utah all the way down to Mexico, across Arizona, 150 feet of elevation gain through the Grand Canyon. Well, at mile 500, which you'll read in here, in the Superstition Mountains, my daughter had her earbuds in and they're going down, and he let his self down a big boulder, about 7,000 pounds. She was in front with her earbuds on, and the earth began to move. And he shoved her out of the way as she could not hear. And it sucked him up. He thought he had enough time to get out from underneath. It sucked him up and rode him 30 feet down. And he was waiting for it just to hit his head, lights out. He knew it. He could feel his bones crushing. Hip, femur, arm, ribs, almost lost his right finger, all of these different things. Anna Lee was able to pull him out. Miracle of the way the rock teetered up. People do not get out from that size of a boulder. She had a satellite phone, all the dramatic that went with that. The 4 hours to get air-vacced out. We had a commitment. People had sponsored this hike. And so she went 3 days later, right back out on the trail. We had to find another person who was that fit, who could keep up with her 25 miles a day for 40 days. Wow. Right, and so she had to go back out knowing her dad's in the hospital. She didn't want to. She had to grit up and finish the goal, which she did. And the beautiful thing is that Luke, you know, being a Barnett, wasn't gonna be stopped by a boulder. He was able to, well, I think just last year, year and a half maybe, he accomplished the last 300 miles that he was not able to accomplish. We started from Mexico and worked north, and I was able to hire a helicopter and go down and find the rock and surprise him with a video crew and Anna Lee, who was pregnant because he saved her life and was married, yes. And so we staked, you know, a verse, you know, in right by that, and just documented that moment. You have an accomplishment, and you know, through Jesus we are more than conquerors, and we will not be moved. And so that's kind of the fun adventure. And so you get to share that. But deep down inside of all of us, every individual person has a desire to make a difference. God, why am I here? How are you going to use me? Really, what intrigues me about difference makers is the vision they have. Where does that vision come from? You know, there's a firestorm experience that happens before a person has a vision that births into something that you act on. Billy Graham is one of those people. We're still talking about him today. The vision he had to travel the world, to fill stadiums, to tell people about the love of Jesus. What happened to him before the vision? I believe that powerful firestorm experience sort of shoved Billy Graham into something he could act on to bring it to his history within the Bible. Moses also was one of these leaders that had incredible vision and leadership. And we see in Exodus 2 and 3, chapters 2 and 3, it talks about how Moses was raised by Pharaoh's daughter, accustomed to the wealth and privilege of the palace, but he was not an Egyptian. He was a Hebrew. In verse 11, it starts talking about how he goes out onto the terrace, and he's looking over to his people, the Hebrews being beat day in and day out, and he's observing this, and something inside of him is stirring. The sights and sounds of a physical beating. I know most of us women don't go to MMA fights and hear that and used to that, but we see enough movies and you hear the cracking of bones and the sights and the sounds and the blood, and once you see it, you can't unsee it. And the sights and sounds of a physical beating is what Moses was being pushed to his absolute emotional limits. Something snapped inside of Moses. And verse 12, it goes on to say, looking this way and that, seeing no one, he killed the Egyptian and buried him in the sand. Moses is coming to the defense of his countrymen. He was not going to stand idly by. So obviously, shortly thereafter, Pharaoh finds out what happens, and Moses has to flee. Which, fast forward to chapter Exodus 3, the burning bush story. He comes upon a burning bush in the desert, consumed, not consumed, it's on fire. He hears a voice from heaven, "Moses, take off your shoes, you are standing on holy ground." Now, I always thought this was the shock and awe, the scaring of Moses into being a difference maker. But in reflecting, it's an attention grabber to stop us, to slow us down. This attention grabber slowed Moses down long enough to hear what God was going to say to him. And what God was going to say to him was already resonating in this difference maker's heart. In other words, God is saying, "Moses, I see what you've seen. I've heard the cries of the people, the suffering. They have reached my ears. And I am calling you, Moses, to set my people free." Please understand what is happening here. God is saying, "I can't stand it anymore either. So Moses, I'm going to do something from heaven. I'm going to make you my agent of change on earth. I'm choosing you because I see you are stirred in your spirit about what stirs me. I see that you are not a man who can stand idly by. I see that you have a passion for your people. You have a capacity for activism. You are a man that I am choosing. I have been waiting and looking for you, Moses." That came through a firestorm experience. "I'm going to use you, Moses, in a positive way. I'm going to take this disruption, and I'm going to use it to build character and leadership and raise you up to be a difference maker." So here's the key. Understand, when God's heart and a human heart align around a cause on heaven and earth that causes angst, that's when a difference maker is born. So how many of us grew up watching Popeye? It looks like, yeah, most of us. So I go to different places. Popeye the Sailor Man. I go to places now and they're like, "What, Popeye's chicken? What are you talking about?" Everyone's young. No one's seen cartoons anymore. I'm like, okay, I'm officially old. That's great. But I'm glad most of us know. I actually spoke about this I was just in Romania last year. I'm like, never talk about Popeye in Romania. Popeye was like a communist sailor. So like he was bad. I'm like, really? No one could have warned me. Don't talk about Popeye in Romania. Popeye the Sailor Man, he had an adorable little girlfriend named Olive Oil. Dogs would bark, men would whistle when Olive Oil would walk by. But when potential harm would come to his beloved Olive Oil, his blood pressure would rise and he would say this line that we've all been burned into our minds, "That's all I can stands. I can't stands no more." That's right. Questionable grammar. He's a sailor. We're just lucky he's not cursing. But he would pop open a can of spinach and eat it, and supernatural strength would flow to his forearms and he would crush all the opposition. But this line, "That's all I can stand. I can't stands no more," it means something to a difference maker because it's something that we've seen and heard that prompts us to get off our backside, to move towards something eternal that we can live our lives for. What can't you stand? Because whatever it is, it's creating a burden inside of you right now. God is speaking to you. He's drawing in, launching you to find your difference-making moment. I will call this a divine disruption. Now, a lot of us don't like to be interrupted, and a disruption is an interruption. We're moms, and it's constant interruptions. But a divine disruption is a life changer. Harriet Tubman could not stand the sights and the sounds of slavery that she and so many of her friends and family were bound by. This pushed her to her absolute emotional limits. And she says, "That's all I can stand." Well, she escapes. She's free. She was brave enough to break free. But guess what? That wasn't good enough for Harriet Tubman. Her being free was not enough. She knew that she had to go back and help other people be free. She had the answer. She went on 13 risky missions, risking her life, didn't even know how to swim, depending on God to rescue 70 of her friends and family from slavery. Because of her knowledge of the lay of the land, the army had used her to advise them to then do missions that would relieve 700 people, rescuing them from slavery. Freedom does not come just for ourselves. True divine disruption freedom is serving other people. What is it that you can't stand? Do you know? Is it an injustice of some kind? Poverty that wrecks you? Racism? Abortion? Human trafficking? God wants to align with you, to give you a vision that you can act on. This vision and acting on will release the firestorm of frustration within you and get on this solution side of something eternal, something that will fuel you and fire you up for the rest of your life because you're on the solution side of the problem. So my question to you today, how can you develop your personal divine disruption? Point number one, I have three that go quick. Every human being has a divine disruption. Now, I don't believe that everything that you see around you is your divine disruption. Otherwise, we are just adopting everything on our skin and we become cranky and bogged down. But when you have your personal burning bush moment, you'll know it. You'll sense God saying to you, this is why you've experienced what you've experienced, good and bad. This is why you've seen what you've seen. This is why you've traveled the world and something attached to your skin and you can't stop thinking about it. So number one, everyone has one. Number two, don't give up looking for it because it's never too late. Listen, you are more qualified. The older you get, the better you get. The better life can be because you are more equipped. God is ready to use your skill sets that you have earned, the scars that you have qualified you for being in your most impactful season yet. That is what is exciting. Like I mentioned before, Tommy started his whole divine disruption of the LA Dream Center, which is now launched into over 300 across the nation and a few international. At the age of 56, at 56, people are thinking about winding down. I found my divine disruption at 47. My true such a time as this moment and calling. Point number three, when you find your divine disruption, feed it. Don't flee it. Many times when we find something that is disturbing, we shop it away, we entertain it away, we turn our head. This doesn't happen here. This is America. We try to get it out of our minds. Move toward what you don't understand, but that bothers you and you can't stop thinking about. Learn about it. Push into that area of unrest because God is directing you to what He is calling you to. So let me share with you my divine disruption. Many dream centers have been birthed in different areas, but we received the most unique dream center that has ever been birthed, and that was because of a brave young lady named Brielle Decker, who escaped from Warren Jeffs' compound. She tried to escape 10 different times, just like Harriet Tubman. She never gave up. She finally escaped from a man who amassed 86 wives and was controlling a community of 14,000 people. Long story short, Brielle Decker found the Phoenix Dream Center. Yes, she did. She found friends there and she said, listen, this is the place I needed when I escaped and had nobody to take care of me. She had been awarded Warren Jeffs compound, 44 bedroom, 29,000 square foot, 10 acre compound. She applied through the trust of a judge in Alaska because she was one of his wives and she was awarded this. She couldn't afford this. There was $350,000 worth of back taxes attached to it. She asked the Dream Center, will you take my house? Will you turn it into the Dream Center? The same thing you do here, will you do it up in Colorado City? Because there's thousands of other women who've been traded and trafficked and entrapped in a systematic human trafficking ring. They are refugees of religious war. They know nothing different. They did not sign up for this. It's a complex story, so I have a short video that'll kind of give you a visual that'll help tell the story.
Known as FLDDF, is a former offshoot of the Mormon Church and supports the practice of polygamy.
The more wives, the more children you can have, the higher in heaven you'll be.
You're taught something from birth, from your mother and your father. You believe them because they're your parents.
It was for our salvation. You do believe in God, even if it was wrong.
Young girls were like a commodity owned by the church.
Warren had himself 78 wives. 24 of those wives were underage.
We're going to go after the criminals. We're going to go after the child abuse.
I was Lynette Warren Jess, the 65th wife of polygamous cult leader Warren Jess. I made a decision to face my fears, and I went back to the very house that I once lived in. I had a type of dream for this house. I went and applied because he's in prison for life. I got his property and was able to partner with a worldwide organization called the Dream Center. So this house is no longer known as Warren Jess House. It is now the Short Creek Dream Center. Angel Barnett, CEO of the Dream Institute, serving Short Creek Dream Center. You've just seen a heartbreaking story and an amazing journey that brings us to where we are right now. You know, the Short Creek Dream Center is a special place that allows families to come in and heal together. Moms and children rescued out of human trafficking, allowing a safe place to heal. You would not believe all the amazing things that are happening. And we are excited to show you. That getting them out of the bedroom was hard. And now they're out there, they're working with several rescue groups because she now has that confidence because she sees it in me. There are thousands of more families just like Ava that are waiting to come into the Dream Center and be a part of a program like this. We do not charge our residents anything, but it does cost $35,000 a year for a family of three to go through the program. We can't do this alone. There's hope for tomorrow, and we're inviting you to be part of this world.
Thank you. Thank you. When we talk about the past so that we can rejoice with what's happening now, this is a community that was controlled and abused through church and religion. Their education was taken away. The power to make a decision was eliminated. A nursing baby would be taken from one mom and given to another. If a man did not obey, as they were victims as well, they would take away and disperse their children and mothers. They would get different birth certificates. We've had a mom come into our Dream Center a year ago, She had six children, and not one child was documented in the U.S. No social security, driver's license, birth certificate. This has been in operation for 100 years, autonomous. So complex that when the AG's office and different organizations tried to do raids, the optics were so bad and so complex. How do you start taking children away from mothers and fixing this problem? That was the wrong way to do it. Only God would have opened a door. We would have never gone looking for an opportunity like this. Amen. Thinking that you're going to penetrate a community, FLDS, for 100 years actively having autonomy to their way of living. Only God could have sent Brielle to the Phoenix Dream Center. Woo! To turn that house from a place of entrapment to a place of freedom. And we use God's love gently as they were abused by religion. We have a food bank that feeds 100,000 pounds of food a month. St. Mary's sends an 18-wheeler every Friday. As the poverty rate is a 49%, there are 70% of the town are children and the rest are single moms who have been imploded by taking the socialistic dictator out of the community. So these moms and children were licensed for them to come into a home. It's a big home, but it feels like a home. It sounds like a home. It smells like a home. There's dinner table conversations. Kids are going off to school now. Our moms are going off to work. They get behavioral health counseling, equine therapy, educational benchmarks are met. Then we have a transition house that Joyce Meyer Ministry just purchased for us. And that allows us for the graduates to go into another program where they have like-minded people who are now paying a program fee because they have a full-time job and a car and daycare. So we're able to simulate what budget coaching, real life, feels like. So we not only just have them rescued, you'll see a picture of some of our ladies that have been rescued and call out to us to be extracted. But then we are able to show the education component. A mom who's never been allowed to read, now she has a GED and her children are rejoicing. And you can see the community outreach within the food bank that provides just the basics. Being the hands and feet of Jesus without strings attached, that's how we won their trust. We were outsiders. And because we came in and for the long haul, with no strings, they now trust us. So that gentleman you see right there, there was 400 young boys kicked out of the community because they were a sexual draw to the young girls. Obviously, that's who you would want to date and marry. But there were only 12 men allowed to procreate. They threw out 400 to 500 lost boys, they call them. Colorado, Arizona, Vegas, all of that. They just dropped them on the side of the road. This amazing man got saved in Las Vegas at a church, met his wife, moved back to Colorado City, where all of the abuse happened in an effort to take back his town. He is a born-again Christian, and he is the mayor of Colorado City. We could have never done that. Only God could do that. The next picture is of a football game. And they did shut down school for 10 years. School has only been open for 2.5 years. And the football team has just started up. We had our first football game a year ago. And it was like a Hallmark movie because the town, our town, Colorado City, did not know who to cheer for. If we were intercepted on, they were on their feet screaming. If they were in the wrong end zone, it didn't matter. They're just happy to be excited about life and free thinking. The ability to celebrate Christmas for the first time with a group of people, to hide Easter eggs for the adults, because they never were able to do that. Those are the beautiful moments of life that the Dream Center is able to hold their hand and walk through. Of people that have been so deeply abused that we are able to walk through. We also have ladies that have been rescued by ex-Delta members, like from the reservation, from the cartel. They are really rampant on the reservation right now. So we've had 7 beautiful Native American women come into our Dream Center working with extraction teams, and we're a safe place for them to decompress and take care of them, get them back on their feet. We have women who come to our Dream Center who are in the middle of the night, decide to get in their car and make a run for it with their child because they can't handle being beat up anymore. So the variety of people that we serve, it's nationwide. It's the Dream Center as a whole, but culturally we've adjusted to a very beautiful place up in Colorado City. A picture of Luke and Constance Meredith. They were graduates of the Phoenix Dream Center. Constance came out of trafficking in Phoenix and went through the program and built the most impactful trafficking recovery program, so much so that our success rate is 95%. And President Trump sent his human trafficking team from DC to view what are your best practices and how are you getting this percentage when normal it's 55% if they're lucky. And so she built that, coming out of her own personal trauma. Her divine disruption translated into building an incredible program. She is now directing the Shore Creek Dream Center and inspiring an entire town. Do you think she would have ever seen that in her future from what she had to endure? She did not stay in the victim category. She buckled down and used that divine disruption, that firestorm experience, to mold and shape her into the leader that is inspiring so many people. Her husband, Luke Meredith, was a field nurse in the Army. He experienced so much trauma by eating breakfast with his comrades in the morning and then attending to them on the same table in the afternoon where they didn't make it. He had access to drugs and he took them. He took them hard, so much that he had 5 heart attacks at the age of 25.
Wow.
He went into the Phoenix Dream Center. He built the greatest veterans program that they've ever had. They got married and I stole them. And now they're up in Short Creek building an entire town that was off limits for 100 years. So much so that he was asked to run for city council. He is now a city councilman for Colorado City, making decisions for a town that we were not even allowed to be in. That is the power and impact of using your past for your future. I have no right to stand in front of our beautiful residents at the Dream Center because I haven't walked a road that gives me and earns the right to speak to them, but that's what they do. We have incredible staff members. Brielle Decker is our last picture. She is a staff member that when the women that come from her community come into the Dream Center that used to be the Prophet's House, they see her. They see a fighter. I said, Brielle, what do you want the world to know? She goes, that we're not stuck in our past, that we're resilient and we have a future. One woman who was feisty enough not to be brainwashed and be robotic. She cut the mold, broke out, and all of this is happening because of her. Who I am, where I'm at today, is because she had enough bravery to do what she did. I never wanted to be doing this. Sue knows, I was happy making lemonade for Take a Plunge Day and handing out some cookies, maybe dancing in the Christmas show. That was fine for me. I never saw this coming. Thanks, but no thanks. I didn't want to be doing this. That's my husband's job. But when I realized the women I now met and got on my skin didn't have a voice, and I was going to be the only voice they had, well, I had to pull my big girl pants up and figure it out and just speak from my heart. And it is a privilege. I can't believe I get to do what I get to do. I have never been more excited. There's never been more stress and responsibility, but this is living. I loved raising my kids, but I really love what I'm called to do right now. This is amazing. have to be sitting in front of the scariest businessmen I've ever met and have to talk about our numbers and the data and the metrics and law and risk, and all of that comes into play with a nonprofit. That's my job, to learn it, to tell the story, to raise the dollars so that we can rescue more people. What if we all would take greater risks? What if all of us, rather than sticking with the status quo, we would be released to impact our homes, our schools, our city, our state, our world? It's all inside of you already. It reminds me of what Jesus says in John 4:4, greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. It's not about us. Are you a broken enough vessel to get gritty and find your divine disruption? Because it's all around us. If we still believe that with God all things are possible, lost people can still be found. Hungry mouths can be fed. Poor people can be pulled out of poverty. Relationships can be reconciled. And it starts with all of us finding our divine disruption. So I will ask you the very dangerous question today. What is it that you can't stand? Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of being challenged, for poking the spiritual bear inside of us, because we know you have more for us. We are made for such a time as this, and I just pray that you would individually give the assignment, and they're going to look different. Their assignment compared to mine is not going to be similar. And it's not supposed to be, because you've made us all so different, and we thank you for that. Thank you for the opportunity to share. We just pray you would sit heavy on your Holy Spirit on each lady, that she would just be able to rest in your inspiration. See how beautiful she is, how uniquely she's been created for such a time as this. And that seasons change who we are today. The assignment that we have been given charge over today, maybe we are in the parenting mode, but we better watch out, because as soon as that door closes, we better get ready for another season, and that's exciting. We are ready, Lord. We stand here and say, choose us, because we will go. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. you.